Good morning. You're with us here on a fresh new edition of Trading Hour. The market is down about 77 odd points. There's 3 hours, 29 minutes. The clock is ticking to the RBI decision, which comes out later in the afternoon. But, you know, the market is not reacting to what may come out of the RBI. It is reacting to what has already happened overnight. And what has already happened is the U.S. yield curve is inverted. U.S. stock markets are down 3%. And generally, there is a scare that maybe growth is starting to slow down in emerging in big markets, in big geographies like the U.S., like Europe, etc., which we'll discuss in some more detail later on the show. But it seems like this is a growth scare going into 2018 close and going into 2019. No big recovery so far. But I must say that, you know, with a 3% cut overnight, and this is not a new one, the disconnect between a sharp U.S. sell-off and a limited sell-off here in India, it's happened before. We've seen, you know, steep cuts earlier as well in the market not reacting with that same full force and enough good reasons for that. I think it's repeating itself. It's a 0.5%, I mean 0.6% kind of a cut, which is not bad. So, good morning.
Good morning. Prashant, for me, this is like a mirror image. It's a replica of yesterday, just inverted. I think inverted is the word of the day, right? So, on the Nifty 50, for instance, the stocks that were rallying yesterday on hopes of resolution of, you know, those trade issues, the entire commodity universe, metals, they are the ones that are taking it on the chin today because of the growth concerns that Prashant mentioned. So, you pull up something like a Vedanta, pull up some of these other sort of metal stocks that we're talking about here, Hindalco, JSW Steel, all of them are pretty weak. And then what was underperforming yesterday, the HDFC twins, that's where the buying is back. You know, the good old names are the ones that are managing to stand tall in what is otherwise a downbeat sort of a market. So there you see days high on HDFC, HDFC Bank also doing pretty well for itself. Broader market is weak. There's no denying that. The breadth of the market, at least as of now, is quite weak. We're looking at less than 600 advancing stocks and what, over, well, almost 1,400 stocks on the declining side. So that's never a great sign. But I think, I mean, some more cues for what it's worth from the RBI. Largely, this market is not expecting anything, expecting the central bank to be fairly dovish.
Yeah.
And it's all about, I think, reading the global picture now.
Oh, yeah. I mean, you know, so there is the global picture and the local picture as well, right? I mean, 7th, that is Friday, we get the exit poll results.
Oh, yes.
Friday is Rajasthan goes to polls, and then later in the evening we get exit polls. Monday the market reacts to exit polls. Tuesday it reacts to actual results. And it's just now, in the next 2 days or so. So there is, I mean, whatever comes out of RBI, I think people will just sort of move on and say, well, now let's look at what the election
the next main
throws
thing.
Up.
Yeah.
Which is, I hope, the last big thing in 2018. But, you know, just to go back and look at what happened in the U.S. market, and these are musings from Alexander Altman, who's the equity strategist at Citi. And to me, it kind of very perfectly captures, you know, somebody looking at this big sell-off in the U.S. and wondering, well, what next, right? And he says, and I quote, "The real struggle from here is to identify an investor base that is willing to step in front of a 3% move lower at this point in the year." I mean, essentially, he's referring to this late in the year. And he goes on to say, well, that someone could indeed be either a very brave soul or someone with sufficient ammunition, which is, I mean, a large enough P&L, to roll the dice one last time in 2018. Absent that, we cannot even say that we are buying equities, U.S. equities, at year-to-date lows yet. We need to fall another 100 points before making that value argument. So, you know, sometimes it's just that you don't really want to go. I mean, if you've got a decent track record, you're up for the year and you see the market falling, you don't want to spoil that by trying to, as he calls it, roll the dice one more time. Very aptly put. So I thought it sort of, and I think, you know, for the rest of the 20 days or so, it's the same every year. I mean, it's not different, but we are in December now. And, you know, let's hope the market stays all right, because for buyers to come in, you know, this late in the year and any great vigor, could be tough, just for that simple reason that you don't want to spoil your record going into the year's close.
Okay, well, let's see how this kind of plays out. For the time being, we've got a index level below 10,800. Let's talk technicals then. We have Sudarshan Sukhani with us this morning once again. Sudarshan, good morning. Good to have you on the show. So after yesterday's kind of you know, indecisive trading action, today at least for now is a down day. Would you at all look at buying this dip, or would you stay out till maybe, you know, till at least a policy announcement is done? What's the index call?
Yeah, good morning again. No, I would not buy this dip. This is not a dip for me. It is the beginning of a correction. The correction could be small or it could be intense. That is something we'll find out later as it develops. but this is not a dip. So I would avoid the Nifty simply because while there are components of the Nifty that are going down, IT and pharma are outperforming. So the Nifty could be choppy as it slides down. I would be a seller in the Nifty bank despite the fact that we all know there is a meeting today and something could happen in that meeting. I do not think the Nifty bank is now willing to go higher. So that's the view. You look to go short in the Nifty bank, completely avoid buying the dip in the Nifty, focus on individual stocks, IT and pharma for buying, and many other mid-cap weak stocks for selling.
Okay, so since you're looking at a reversal of sorts, then what looks most vulnerable, Sudarshan, on the Nifty itself, for instance, I mean, would you even look at some of the stronger names, the leaders of the November rally, like the Reliances of the world, like the HDFC Twins?
HDFC Twins look vulnerable. The entire banking sector looks vulnerable. And individual small names in the Nifty, the metals, look like as if they are willing to go down. Even consumer goods, FMCG is ripe for a correction. So except for some pharma stocks selected and IT, the entire pack looks ready for a dip. I have buy ideas and sell ideas which match this concept. HCL Tech is a buy. And in fact, not only HCL Tech, you could buy Tech Mahindra or even TCS. So it's all three of them are buying opportunities. But Vedant is a short sell. Vedant is a short sell. Hindalco is a short sell. For today, I have Vedant. But you could be looking to sell any of the metal stocks. All of them are looking ahead for lower levels. And Sun TV is a short. Sun TV is breaking down from support levels. So primarily, a lot of mid caps are now offering themselves to short selling. And IT is a buy.
Okay. Fair enough. We have a question from viewer Sudarshan coming your way. Sumukh Bagaitakar wants your view on Titan. I mean, his time horizon is 1 year. What would you tell him?
I think he should hold. The time horizon is 1 year. Titan is an outperformer and he'll probably get a 20-25% return in 1 year's time in Titan from current levels. So just stay put. You know, the big money is made when you are patient and you can make big money in Titan.
Okay, all right. Big money on Titan can still be made. That's the call. Thanks, Darshan, for joining in and giving us your view on the index and those stocks. Speaking of stocks, let's actually move on to some of them which are in focus. Bharat Forge is actually taking it on the chin today. Stock is down almost 6-7%. Not just Bharat Forge, even Ramakrishna Forgings is trading lower. Now, the reason for this is that the North America Class 8 truck order numbers for the previous month are pretty poor. In fact, they've come in at the lowest level since September of last year. Let's get in Sonia to understand this. Sonia, not great news for a company like Bharat Forge?
Well, it's not great news also because it's come as a bit of a shock. You know, in the month of October, last month, you had 43,000 units of Class 8 truck orders, and FTR, which is the Intel analysis company that puts out the report, had in the month of October indicated that there was significant demand traction seen in the North America truck orders business. And this month, it's come as a bit of a shock. Similar is the case that you've seen in our own markets, right? The MHCV sales for the month of November slowed down substantially, and that came as a bit of a shock for the Indian markets as well. So clearly the overarching theme is a slowdown in MHCV sales across the globe. The numbers are the lowest that we've seen since September of 2017. And it does impact both Bharat Forge and Ramakrishna Forgings. Bharat Forge gets about 13% of their revenues from the North America truck business. Ramakrishna Forging gets about 20%. So that's the reason you're seeing a bit of a slowdown there. Also because Bharat Forge in its recent press release post Q2 numbers indicated that demand trends are very strong. And the strong demand trends are expected to continue in the second half of the year. So these numbers have come as a bit of a negative surprise. And that's why the sharp reaction on the stock.
Okay, Sonia, would you imagine this kind of a number would make brokers take up and sort of sit up and take notice as well, because this goes against what they guided?
Yes, you know, also because it goes against what the Intel analysis guided as well. Just to give you the key statement that came in last month's report, FTR said that freight volumes are expected to be healthy well into the second half of 2019, keeping capacity utilization at extremely tight levels for an extended period of time. Now, the North American Class 8 truck orders for the previous 12 months came at a healthy 504,000 units. So this kind of a slowdown is against the guidance that, you know, the the Intel analysis suggests from last month itself. So I guess maybe there could be some scaling down of estimates. I'm not too sure about that. But generally, the tone is much worse than what was expected.
Okay, all right, thanks Sonia very much for that. So not great news for a lot of the auto companies and the auto component makers as well, because those are North American truck orders. Okay, let's just address the news that's coming in on your screens, and it's something that's not gone Jio's way with respect to a cartelization case, because the Supreme Court has dismissed the Competition Commission of India's plea in this matter. It was Jio versus the incumbents. Let's get in Ashmit to understand exactly what the court has said. Ashmit, if you could just run us through the background of the case and exactly what transpired today.
Well, essentially, this is a dispute that began with the genesis of Jio, with Jio making that spray into the telecom space. And with that, there was a big dispute last year as well, where Jio, as a part of that dispute, had in fact approached the CCI, and they had made it clear that the three incumbents, that's Bharti, Idea, as well as Vodafone, are ganging up, are cartelizing against Jio, and that was the complaint that was submitted before CCI. Subsequent to that, last year itself, the CCI had sought to initiate a probe on cartelization against the three telcos. However, the three telcos then moved to Bombay High Court. Their argument was quite clear. They argued that as far as telcos are concerned, as far as their contract terms are concerned, that is governed solely and regulated solely by the TRAI, that CCI just does not have the jurisdiction. Now, that appears to be a position that was bought into by the Bombay High Court, as in September of last year, they held that CCI lacks jurisdiction. Subsequently, the CCI then moved the Apex Court, and they again made the same prayer about the ability, about the jurisdiction to probe these charges of cartelization against the three companies. Now, what we understand, the order was very, very brief, but in governing this dispute between TRAI and CCI, and the ability of the CCI to go ahead and to probe the charges of cartelization, the Apex Court has held that the CCI, as of right now, does not have the jurisdiction, that this requires further deliberation, and that as of right now, no go-ahead has been given. The CCI plea has been dismissed. What that effectively means is that the CCI, at this position, their probe on cartelization against Bharti Idea Vodafone is a non-starter. It cannot proceed. The CCI plea has been dismissed. We're still awaiting clarity on what the terms of reference of the orders are, whether the order has directed the TRAI to perhaps take a look on the issue. That is something that we're still awaiting. We're still getting clarity from the councils. But on the limited issue of the CCI probe, it's a non-starter as of now. Right now, their plea has been dismissed. They cannot go ahead and probe the charges of cartelization against Bharti Idea or Vodafone. Back to you.
Ashmit, thanks very much. So that is important story to take note of, and we'll get you more details, as Ashmit pointed out, when we get them. Jet Airways should come up on your screen. I mean, 15 days back, the stock was at about 370 rupees. It's back at about 300, but it's still very much in news. The news, of course, is the fact that promoter Naresh Goyal, who owns 51% in Jet, is apparently closing in on a fund infusion deal with Etihad. Etihad holds 24% of the airline. Goyal is said to have assured pilots' union that fresh funds will be infused into the company around mid-December to help the company stay afloat and flourish. We have Anu Sharma now with details on what is being worked out. Anu, go on.
Sources have told us that Jet Airways India Limited is likely to see a fund infusion from Etihad Airways, and an announcement in that regard is likely to happen in the next 15 days, as early as December 15th. Now, sources have told us that in a meeting which was held on November 26th, the airline's promoter, Naresh Goyal, has assured the pilots that all the salary dues will be paid in a matter of 4 months, and from April 1, there'll be no delay in salaries. On a meeting which is to be held on December 6th, that is tomorrow, a plan will be communicated to the pilots whereby they'll be told how the salaries of October and November will be paid, whether they'll be paying a 1.5-month salary in one go, or whether all the salary dues will be cleared beforehand. With respect to the Tata deal, sources tell us that that has apparently been called off because Tatas were pressing for shutdown of Jetlite, which is the low-cost subsidiary of Jet Airways, and also were demanding a non-compete clause, which did not go down well with the promoter of Jet Airways. So that deal looks like has gone on a back burner, and now the deal with Etihad fund infusion will be coming. Now, with Etihad's stake increasing, sources tell us that you might see more flights to Abu Dhabi, which is Etihad's hub. What remains to be seen is when exactly this deal gets announced and what the other exact contours of it, that we'll, of course, keep an eye out for. Back to you.
Okay, all right, Anu, thanks very much for that. So that's Jet Airways and the latest on their plans of trying to deleverage their balance sheet. Let's just now move to one stock that's actually been on a bit of a tear, Adani Gas. The recent listing from the Adani fold has actually gained almost 50% since that listing happened. And even today, after being locked in circuit actually for a good bit, it's now up about 8%. So what is powering this kind of move on Adani Gas? Let's go across to Sonal to get the details. Sonal, what is happening here?
Well, actually, Surbhi, there is no incremental news that would trigger such a huge rally in Adani Gas stock. In fact, it listed at 72 rupees per share, where we were actually expecting listing to be around that 40 to 45 rupees per share. So even listing was it at a huge premium. What is actually triggering it? There is no incremental news yet again, but the company informed the exchanges on 21st November that they have received authorization to expand footprints in 13 geographical areas. Also, they have received approval for bids for around 9 geographical areas in joint venture with IOCL. But that was already known back in August. So what is really triggering it? The financials. They are pretty strong for the company. If we talk about the volumes, they are lowest in the city gas distribution space, in the listed city gas distribution space, that is. It stands around 1.4 MMSCMD that they reported in FY18. However, the EBITDA per SCM is at 10.10 rupees. This is something that we use to track the operational efficiency of any CGD company. That is highest in the listed players. Also, the debt is at around 310 crore rupees. This compares with a debt of around 2200 crores in Gujarat Gas versus nil debt in Mahanagar Gas and IGL. However, the company is on an expansion phase, so of course the debt levels might increase here on. Talking about the CAGR over FY14-18, the company has done well. Sales volume CAGR has been around 4.5%. Revenue CAGR also has been around 4%. But profitability growth has been quite impressive. They have been able to increase profits by around 25% in last 4 years. So that is quite impressive and something that the company can work on. The guidance also is very robust. The company says that they expect volumes to be at around 10.5 MMSCMD by FY25. That compares with 1 MMSCMD that they are reporting right now. CNG stations are also expected to increase to 1,030 by FY25. But all this growth, does it reflect in the company's price? No. The average sector valuations are at around 17 times FY20 EPS, while IGL, MGL and Gujarat Gas are trading around that level. Adani Gas is currently trading at 46 times FY20 EPS. So definitely, the valuations are high, but they are promising a lot of growth. Back to you.
Okay. How much to pay for that kind of growth is the question. I mean, and valuations is... Sonal pointed out, seems very out of whack. 46 times on FY20 compared to average valuations between, just under 20, basically. Well under 20, actually. Sonal, thanks very much for that comprehensive sort of wrap out on Adani Gas. No fresh triggers, but I mean, just a background to help you understand where it came into the market at, where it is now at, and, business-wise, what things are looking like.